Hi, and welcome to Saturday Night Spiritual from Founders MCC here in Hollywood. I'm the Reverend Sheena Metal, and I am the interfaith minister here at Founders MCC. MCC, of course, Metropolitan Community Church, Founders, the original church in the MCC denomination, and honored to be here the second Saturday of every month at 5 o'clock Pacific time. You can find us at foundersmcc.org and on Founders MCC's Facebook page and YouTube page, both of which are very active and very wonderful. Also, SaturdayNightSpiritual.com. That's our community page. And if you just want to go to an archive page and watch past services, I have a special page just for that, RevSheenaFoundersMCC.com. It'll give you pretty much the whole list over the last 4 years, and you can just go click and watch and soak in some of the God. And I love that story. I'm honored to be here. This is my our musical guest today, Adrian Christian, was reminding me this is our fourth year. 4 years ago today, he performed at a service, my first Christmas service. So this is my fourth, and I've been doing this since June of 2019. Honored to be here. I love my gig here. I love being a part of this wonderful church. I'm hoping to get involved in the church in another capacity next year that I can't wait to tell you about. And I'm happy to be the interfaith pastor. Happy holidays. Happy holidays to you. Really quick, because I kind of have to talk about this every month. What does interfaith mean? Because there are still people that when I say I'm an interfaith pastor, I see the eyes kind of circle in the saucer. Like they're, you know, like when your CD used to skip before, those who remember CDs before, when it would just roll around in the machine before the laser caught the groove. Trying to figure out what it means, and they're not wanting to say the wrong thing because they don't want to speak incorrectly, but they don't really know what it means. And that always kind of surprises me. Because to me, interfaith is where it all begins. Interfaith is the world. I remember when I was in college, there was this great bumper sticker, and it had like every spiritual symbol that you could think of. It had a cross, it had a Star of David, it had the crescent star, it had an ohm symbol, it had a yin yang, it had everything. And at the end, it said evolve. And I love that because I think that was the first time that I visually saw through symbols the magic of interfaith spirituality. And when I was growing up, and I knew that I didn't want to be like many of the evangelical Christian folks that were in the neighborhood, the community that I grew up in Orange County, California, I knew I wasn't that. So I just assumed I was nothing. And by nothing, I don't mean not a spiritual person or a person of faith. But I thought there wasn't a title for me. So when people asked me if I was a Christian, I would say, I'm not. Or are you religious? I'm not. And I would say, I'm just spiritual. And I'm just spiritual. And that was the way that I said, I believe, but I don't have a thing. And then when I saw that bumper sticker and I started thinking about the idea of what that all meant, and then I heard the term interfaith spirituality. And I thought, that's what I am. I'm interfaith. Now I have also reclaimed my Christianity. I consider myself a Christian pastor because of this church. I love the teachings of Christ. I also love the teachings of Buddha. I love the deity Ganesh. I love so many traditions in the Jewish faith. There are so many things that I love. I love my New Age community. So interfaith just seems to work. Now, the thing for me that's strange is, and I talk about this every month on the service, I believe we are all interfaith. Because if you are identified as something, even if that thing is agnostic or atheist, if you identify as something and you acknowledge that the world is made up of people who are either other things or the same thing as you, and you imagine humanity, we'll start with just humanity because we live on the earth, humanity as a pie, and each one of us is a piece of the pie. And maybe, you ever seen like at parties, they'll bring a pie and every slice of the pie is a different kind of pie? First of all, I'm fascinated and I want to eat the whole pie. but moving on. So each piece of the pie, right? Let's say the pumpkin pie is Judaism and the apple pie is Christianity and the chocolate pie is New Age and the coconut pie is Muslims. And you just keep moving your way around the pie, right? That is interfaith. Interfaith is the pie of many colors. You pick your slice. And for some people like me, your slice is a sliver of this and a sliver of that and a sliver of this. For some people, your slice is, oh, I always get the pumpkin. And that's your what you consider your spirituality. And you pick that up and go. But you acknowledge as you do that there is a pie of many colors in front of you. And you are just a piece of that pie. And I think that as human beings, we would think of the world and our existence in a whole different way if we just acknowledged our place in the pie. And it takes nothing away from you. It takes nothing away from your own spirituality. It's just you identify with your own unique spiritual ideologies, your faith, and you understand everybody else's faith still lives in the pie tin. And that, you know, because obviously it's, you know, celebrating the birth of Jesus this month on Christmas. And to me, when I read the teachings of Christ, I don't see Jesus as an exclusive Christian. I see Jesus as very interfaith, very much speaking to the everyone. Very universal ideals of community and connection and love. Not us, my God and your God, not, you know, this and you and us and them. And no, Jesus ministered in a very universal way. And that's what I call this service. I call Saturday Night Spiritual a universal, light-based, love-filled service. And to me, that title could be used for anything that Jesus said. To me, everything that came from Christ was universal, it was light-based, and it was love-filled. And it was not just a message for the Jewish people that he was reaching. It was not just a message for what would later become Christians. It was a message for the world and for the universe. And that's one of my favorite things about Christmas. I'll tell you a little something about Christmas, and God forbid a service go by, I don't talk about my mama, but my mom was what I would say as a kid growing up in the 70s, a closeted metaphysician. So she had, you know, the dragons and she had fairies and she had crystals and she read Sylvia Brown, but it was all a little bit on the download of the world. And after she died, I found out she practiced witchcraft. I didn't even know that. I found a cauldron and dragon's blood. I didn't know what was going on. I called a friend of mine. It's a witch. And I said, what's happening? She said, sweetheart, your mom was practicing. So there were things even I didn't know that she was doing. But when it was Christmas, let me tell you something. My mom was obsessed with wise men. Those wise men would come out and she had a nativity that took all of the China Hutch, all of the other China Hutch, and all around the dining room table. And then when we got a piano, then it was all over the entire dining room. I don't even know where she got all this stuff. I think she probably had more shepherds than there were in at the time. I mean, I think she probably got more shepherds than existed in the Middle East at that time. But she loved Jesus. She loved the birth of Jesus. And she told me once that she believed that anything that she believed in, whether it was a crystal or a Buddhist ideology or, you know, something to do with we are not alone as far as life on other planets or earth magic, whatever it was, she believed everything Jesus said fit with that. And she believed that the message that Jesus was trying to tell us was to lift us up and to show us what my theme and sermon for this service is. You are joy for the world. Every time people sing Joy to the World, the Christmas Carol, and I love that song, I always think of Jesus smiling because the lyric, Joy to the world, the Lord has come. I always think of Jesus thinking, yeah, but you all are joy for the world. You are joy for the world. So that's what I want you to think about this whole time. I have some wonderful guests today. I have a dear friend is going to come up right now and do some music. Adrian Christian, 4 years ago, he did my first Christmas Saturday Night Spiritual. Then we all got consumed by a tiny global pandemic. It's good to have him here, and I would like him to perform some music for you. Adrian, it's all yours, sweetheart. Thank you for being here.
So great to be with you.
When I first saw you, I already knew there was something inside of you, something I thought that I would never find, angel of mine.
And now, for all of you guys out there who still believe in Santa Claus, as I do, I want to give you another piece of our Christmas story. You know, Saint Nicholas, And this is a recording. And I know how much Sheena loves Karen Carpenter. And I recorded this song in her arrangement. So I'm going to do it, and I will definitely do this live. So let me just get this up here. And here it is. Here we go. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He's making a list, checking it twice. He's gonna find out who's naughty or nice. Santa Claus is coming to town. He sees you when you're sleeping. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good, for goodness sake. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming to town. He knows when you're awake. He knows if you've been bad or good. So be good, for goodness sake. You better watch out. You better not cry. You better not pout. I'm telling you why. Santa Claus is coming. Santa Claus is coming. Santa Claus is coming to town. Coming to town. For some reason, I don't hear you.
There you go. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I said it is true that as a small child, I absolutely did love Karen Carpenter, and I still think that when she sang, she channeled.
Yeah, absolutely. She did, and she was an angel on earth, really. And she had purity in her voice. She was pure, you know, and like you said, it came through her.
Yes, absolutely. I think I've seen that, you know, in my life with some performers. Where do you believe when you perform that you channel?
I do. And I think that in certain situations, when everything is all in place, and I'm not thinking of the technical aspects of here. It really happens. It all comes together. There are moments that are magical. Sometimes I'm not there. Sometimes I have to get out of my head. If I let it, it's there. It's definitely right. there. It's just right. a matter of doing this technology is right. quite challenging. And we set up here. I have had some help from my engineering teacher, but we set up all day long just to get this just right. And there are like nothing but wires on the ground, you know. So it's to get the sound and then to get the music and then to get the audio and the voice and then the songs. So and then the lighting, you know. And yeah. so if I step out once I'm here, I feel I'm here with everyone now. And once we started singing, I felt, you know, it happening. So,
well,
yeah,
don't you think that's because when you're prepping everything, and I certainly do that here with my producer, Emery. But then, because that's your earthbound self, right?
Exactly.
But when the creation begins, that's when your spiritual self takes over.
You know, and that happens in church services too. I've been singing in churches for decades, and especially, well, I'm only 29, but for decades. And, you know, and right before the service, that half hour before the service begins, everyone's scrambling. All the people, all the clergy, all the people are scrambling. And then, click, and somehow it's there. And we have a prayer usually. Yeah. I usually have a private prayer of my own. And then let it go. And so it's the preparation, if it's all there. But this was my first outing of doing this, in a few years. So of having all my equipment here doing this with you and doing this through your stream. So I feel good. I feel good that everything's working. So I'm happy.
Tell you what, two things. One, you're wonderful. And everybody, Adrian's going to be back doing two more songs at the end of the service. And two, let's talk because I want you to come back and do this more. Your energy in the middle of this is so beautiful that it warms my heart.
I love that you ask and reach out to me, and you and I have a kindred spirit. We have yes. something that was there from the first time that we met, yes. and we were. I was reaching you about this Olivia Newton-John that we can enter later, but being yes. right now in December and being you had this, you wanted to do something special for spiritual, and I was down. So I'm so happy to see you guys and everybody that's watching.
We'll see you a little bit later in the service. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Christmas is such a special time for me, and it's a time for family. And, you know, I'm a person that, except for my mom, who was, the best, I did not have a family. So I didn't grow up going to big family parties. My mom would make like an 8-course meal for Christmas, and then we would sit on TV trays and eat. That was how we did Christmas. And it was great. We'd watch movies and I'd make her watch every Christmas Carol adaptation. And it was fantastic. I was just watching an adaptation last night with my spirit nephew. I now have a wonderful family of friends that are truly my family. And we watched a version of A Christmas Carol he hadn't seen, which is because we're both nuts about Christmas Carol. And I love that part at the end. And I will paraphrase because I don't have it in front of me, where Charles Dickens says, when Scrooge has the revelation Christmas morning, Scrooge was better than his word. You know, he became a better man and a better friend than you would see anywhere. And to Tiny Tim, who did not die, he became a second father. And I'm crying as I say that because that message of that novel, which is my favorite novel. It's been my favorite novel since I was 4, and it's still my favorite novel, is about how every single day we wake up and we're given the chance to change our life forever. And that was a beautiful message from Mr. Dickens. And honestly, I believe a Christ message, right? That at any minute you can say, okay, these things were not good, but I have so many more days on the earth. And I can make it better, and I can be better, and I can be a better human and a better friend, and I can be an uncle to someone, an aunt to someone, a father figure, a mother figure. I can be a mentor. I can be a pastor. All of these things, you can fix it. And for people who think, oh, my life's already over, my clients will say, oh, it's too late. I'll never find love. I'll never do the things I want to do. I'll never get healthy. I'll never get happy. No, God gives us a chance. And that is part of the spirit of Christmas, to remember God gives us a chance to start over again and become who we want to become and move forward in love and in light. And that's important. That is what the most important message probably that you will receive from spirit, or as for Ebenezer Scrooge, from spirits at any time, is that any morning you can wake up and throw open the curtains and say, now I'm going to be somebody else. Now I'm going to be who I've always wanted to be. Now I'm going to let everything go and I'm just going to live in love. Now I'm going to buy the biggest turkey in the world and I'm going to take it to someone's house just to bring joy. Scrooge on Christmas morning became joy for the world. And man, that's the best. Okay, Spirit of Christmas would not be complete without my dear friend and our social justice minister at Founders MCC, the wonderful Lucia Chappelle is here with us. It's wonderful to have you here, my friend. Hi,
here I am. I'm here.
How are you? Shana. Merry Christmas.
Oh, Merry Christmas, Merry Christmas, and you know, happy Christmas, Hana Kwanzaa.
Yeah, and you are, right? You are very much a person of interfaith. You are a very much a fan of all of the spiritualities that exist, and acknowledging that your faith just heightens the faith of everyone else, right?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And at this time of year, I'm so fascinated by the connections and the associations of solstice and all that that means, and Yule and all that that means, and incarnation, incarnation, bringing it, you know, God becoming human. I did some alternate lyrics to Joy to the World. And one of the lines was, in choosing to be human, God joins in our communion.
That's
what this time is. And realizing it, you know, in the Christmas carol, how each of the spirits incarnates a certain concept, you know, in the incarnation of the past.
Yes.
The incarnation of the present, the incarnate. And then it asks you, what will you incarnate?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of spirit will you incarnate?
Yes. Yes. My favorite lyric from Joy to the World is, and heaven and nature sing, because it really shows the universe, right? That it's everything here, everything tangible about the earth world, Reverend Lucia, but it's also everything about the heavens. And how it's not their place and our place. It's just one place that we all live as the we, whether you're a biological being or you're in spirit, we're all here together and we're all celebrating things together, whatever the earth celebration was, in that case, the birth of Christ, but whatever the celebration is, and heaven and nature sing. I love that. I might say that now every time on every month here. Because what a great idea that everything in the universe got together and sang. And because it was such a good thing that this light was being brought to the earth.
I was driving in my car one day listening to Hark the Herald Angels Sing. And I was, because, you know, what I work in my head is, you know, what do those old lyrics really mean to me?
Sure.
And really mean now? Am I looking for angels? Am I harking for angels? What does that mean? And the line that came to me was, feel creation grow more whole. That's the sensation. That's the suddenly waking up and realizing that creation has become more whole. Our human and all life connections are crystallizing. You love crystals. Let's crystallize.
I do. I think whatever there is in the world, you should throw a crystal at it. I absolutely do. Yeah, but isn't that beautiful? And even in A Christmas Carol, right? The ghost of Christmas past very much represented an old Earth Mother shaman, right? Sometimes she's shown more as a fairy, sometimes she's shown more as an angel, but she always has this energy of the wise mother who is showing the past. And then Ghost of Christmas Present is Father Christmas, right?
Mm-hmm,
so, and then the Ghost of Christmas Future is the Grim Reaper, which we think of as being a bad thing. Oh, the Grim Reaper. But the truth is the Grim Reaper is simply a ferryman who carries you from one place to the next. It's not a bad thing. It just is a thing, right? When you got to go, you want somebody with you. Now, we portray him as the hood and the sickle and the scary. But the truth is, if you've had a near-death experience, as I have had, the ferrymen are lovely. There's nothing. Somebody to guide you across. I mean, what a great job. You know, what a fantastic thing. It's like a celestial concierge. It's wonderful. But yeah, I mean, just the idea of the representation of that. It's interesting because my nephew is a professional Santa, and he was a guest on my weekly talk show last week, and he taught what he calls the Santa priesthood, which is everyone who does, who participates in being Santa, whether you're wearing the beard or you're just bringing the Santa energy. And he was talking about how throughout the ages, Santa was represented by what the people at the time needed, right? He was very pagan. Then for a while, he was actually looked like a bishop. He was very Catholic. And then in the Victorian era, then he was very old world. And then in the Victorian era, he became more very gentle because the people needed that. Then Coca-Cola came and he became very representative of our modern world. That is what we need Santa to be, right? And I think that's beautiful. And I think in a lot of ways, Jesus is what we need Jesus to be. Like, we call on Jesus in our lives for whatever we need at the time, right? What kind of Jesus do you need? And I think that's what tapping into the light is to me. What is your favorite part about the story of the birth of Jesus?
What's my favorite part? That's tough. Especially this time, I'm walking into Advent. So I'm kind of experiencing each part, you know, step by step. My favorite part. Well, I love me some Mary.
Okay.
I love me some Mary. And I love that because she, in her experience, look at what we have. We have this woman trusting the magic that God creates.
Hmm.
And we have the turning of the seasons.
Mm.
You know, the sun's return, S-O-N-S-U-N. It's all wrapped up in there. And in the body of a mother.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Especially at this time when we have mothers in distress in so many different ways, you know, mothers being bombed and mothers being denied medical care. And, you know, what a world this is, Sheena, that we're facing at this Christmas, during this Advent. Holy moly.
And how important for us to be here today as two of the mothers of Founders MCC. I mean, as female pastors, we are bringing the mother energy, right? I love that.
That always sounds so funny to me. I'm still a kid. I'm nobody's mother.
I don't know, but I think I was born 50, so I'm okay with it.
Well, there's that.
I love Christmas, and I love you, and I thank you for being here, sweetheart.
It's been so lovely to be with you. happy, happy, happy everything to everybody.
Yeah.
And positive peace energy to all.
Beautiful. Thank you, sweetie. Everybody, our social justice minister, the wonderful Reverend Lucia Chappelle, whom I love so much. We got maybe an announcement next year. Lucia and I are cooking something up. So be prepared. Something good is coming. It's always something good. Mary. Okay, interesting. Interesting. For me, it's the wise men. Because, yes, my mother was obsessed with them. But at the time she was obsessed with them, it was pre the History Channel. I don't think we really even understood that the wise men were oracles. They were psychics, as was my mother, as am I. They got the psychic hit, right? That something important was happening and they had to go. And they went miles and miles and miles to get to Jesus, following a star. It doesn't get more new agey than that, more metaphysical than that. The thing I love the most about them is, as a child, we're taught they brought frankincense, myrrh, and gold. And we think, oh, these rich guys came, right? They're portrayed in the velvet and the gold thread and the silks and the satins and the best materials and the fancy saddles and the expensive camels. And here they come with their riches. But the truth is that frankincense and gold and myrrh are three of the biggest elements for protection. They're spiritual protection elements. You want to protect your house, you burn frankincense and myrrh. I wear gold on my solar plexus chakra to protect me all the time. So really what they were doing was they knew how special this little human was going to be. So they were bringing protection from him because they knew that even as a baby, his life was being threatened. And they wanted to make sure they protected him. That's why they are my favorite part of the Christmas story. But I have a whole new thought about Mary now after talking to Lucia. And I love that too. This is Founders MCC Saturday Night Spiritual. We're the interfaith service here every Saturday at 5 o'clock Pacific time. I'm Reverend Sheena Metal, the interfaith pastor at Founders MCC. And this is our special Christmas service. And it's You Are Joy for the World. So one of my dear friends is Stuart Milk. His uncle, of course, was Harvey Milk. And Stuart founded the Harvey Milk Foundation with one of Harvey's best friends. When I first met him, he did my radio show. That's how we met. And after we finished the show, he said, "This was great. My uncle had this expression I loved, and it was, you are medicine for the world." And oftentimes when he did my show, he talked about how doing my show was medicine for the world and how it's important to be medicine for the world. And I've always loved that expression, that we are the medicine that can fix the world. And I love that Harvey Milk came up with that. So when this came to me, when I got the download from Spirit for this today, I loved it because we sing a lot about joy and joy for the world, right? Joy to the world. And you know, Jesus has come and there's joy. But I really believe, as I said earlier, that if Jesus were here and I was interviewing Jesus on Saturday Night Spiritual, he would say, you are joy for the world. We all are joy for the world. We all have the ability to be the joy and bring the joy to the world. When we're singing joy to the world, we're not just singing about Jesus. We're not just singing about Jesus coming. We're singing about joy. We're bringing joy. Christmas is joy. The season is joy. Being benevolent to people is joy. Giving someone a gift or a listen or a helping hand or a smile, that's joy. Every day, we have the ability to bring joy to the world. And I'm going to go back to A Christmas Carol. Here is a character, Ebenezer Scrooge, that through most of the novel is taking. He's what my mother used to say, sucking the oxygen out of the room. Like everywhere he goes, people are like, oh, God, it's that guy. And his poor Bob Cratchit, his secretary, oh, you know, and then he goes to the restaurant and they're like, oh, and he comes home and his maid is like, his housekeeper is like, oh, everybody, right? Even his best friend who has had the enlightenment, Jacob Marley, of dying and coming back to warn him, and Scrooge is not listening. And Jacob Marley's like, oh, this guy. But then he has the awakening and he wakes up Christmas morning and he switches from a taker to a giver. He stops sucking the oxygen out and he starts becoming joy for the world. And not only does that lift up everyone around him, but it lifts him up because it feels much better to be a joy bringer than it feels to be someone who's always bringing everything down. It doesn't feel good to others and it doesn't feel good to you. So think about that. Think about during this Advent, during this holiday season, how can I become joy for the world? How can I make that my New Year's resolution? How can I become joy for the world? And with that, I'd like to bring up some true joy for the world, Founders MCC's senior pastor and my own clergy mentor, the wonderful Pastor Keith Mazingo. How are you, my friend?
I'm fine. How are you?
I'm good. It's good to have you here.
Thank you. You see, I'm at the church.
Oh,
we just
yay!
Had a memorial service. Yes, I love these windows in the background.
Rest in peace, our beautiful Norm Cox.
Yes, and I'm here with my friend, Reverend Eric Buter.
Hello.
Hi, how are you?
I'm well, thank you. How are you?
I'm wonderful. It's wonderful to have you here. Thank you for being here with us.
Thank you.
You'll hear more from him soon.
I love that. So what do you think about what I was talking about, Pastor Keith, about how important it is to bring joy to the world?
Well, of course, we do this all the time, right? It's one of the four traditional words that Christian churches use for Advent, right? We do hope, peace, joy, and love. And joy, of course, Lucia talked to you about Mary, and that's the word for the third Sunday of Advent, which is the Mary Sunday and the pink candle thing and all of the liturgy that goes along with that. But it's not just joy. All of those things are tied together with the hope and the peace and the joy and the love. All of that's tied together. And one of the things that we talked about at our creative worship team meeting this week, some of the churches, I think it's the United Methodist Church denomination, is going to not light the candle of peace this Sunday, even though that's part of the Advent liturgy, to be in solidarity with, because there's so much unrest in other places, even near the very city of Bethlehem. I mean, thinking yes. Bethlehem is 50 miles from where the bombs are dropping, right? And so, and that it's a Palestinian city. It's not in Israel, it's in Palestine. And so, keeping all of that in perspective during this season, so much, we've been robbed of so much of hope and peace and joy and love through this pandemic time, that as we start to gather again, even though we're still traumatized at gathering, and obviously having several of our church leaders at home with COVID right now,
right?
It's not gone. So what do? We have to, it's up to us as God's people and as people who are practicing this and live it every day. I'm a joyful person. People think I'm happy all the time. And truthfully, I really am happy most of the time. I may be sad at times and still have joy underneath it all, because joy and happiness are two different things. I may not be happy about some situation or some person or some problem or whatever, but still have joy in my spirit because I've lived long enough to know that God's brought me through all of these things in the past, and God will bring me through the next thing too.
Yes.
And so I hope that my life conveys that joy. It's not just that I have to preach joy or that we just have to focus on joy in a particular service alone. Yes, this is wonderful, and I'm glad you're doing it today. But I think it's important that we set the example that that happens all the time. It just is part of our being. It's part of our living.
Well, some of it has to do with the fact that people sometimes really don't believe they are the joy. They think the joy comes from outside of them. They don't understand that that spirit, God, has placed the joy inside of us, and that each of us is here to be a joy bringer. And they get in a different mindset of thinking, oh, joy's for somebody else, or I'm not the one to bring the joy, or there are other earthly things like greed and covetousness and being right all the time that are mourned, that those are my things, the joy is not for me. I think if somebody just sat every human being down and said, you are joy for the world, we might have a different world, you know?
Sometimes it takes a little convincing for people to know that, though. And I think we don't always choose to recognize the joy inside of us. We get stuck on the of whatever situation we're in. I mean, one of the things that we talked about today, and there were three of us ministers that spoke today at Norm's memorial, and we talked about what a joyful person he was. Does that mean he was happy every minute? Does that mean he was laughing every minute? Does that mean he never had problems? No, of course not. It doesn't mean we did either. But there's a deeper something inside of us that creates that joy that we have to train ourselves to recognize, to be aware of. And
yes,
and
yes.
I believe you're absolutely right. I believe it's the spirit that makes that happen. And it's in our spirit. And if our spirit is one with God's spirit, well, then, you know, we should be able to recognize all of those different things that the spirit brings. But we haven't been trained to do that. We've been trained that, oh, if I stump my toe, all I concentrate is the pain. I don't concentrate on the joy that the rest of my body is not in pain. Right.
Yes, 100%. What is your favorite part of the story of the birth of Jesus?
Oh, my favorite part. I think my favorite part is the angels appearing to just different groups. In fact, tomorrow's message, and maybe it's just because it's on my mind so much, but tomorrow I'm talking about the song "It Came Upon the Midnight Clear," and it was written by it was written by a Unitarian minister who was suffering from depression. And they had just gone through the Mexican-American War, and there were all these revolutions going on in Europe, and slavery was a hot topic here in the States that led to the Civil War. He was just depressed. And in spite of that, he writes this song to talk about the angels that in the midst of his depression, in the midst of all warfare, in the midst of bombs dropping, in the midst of revolutions, in the midst of slavery, we've got to still pay attention. All of that noise around us is drowning out the sound of the angels who are trying to bring joy. They're trying to bring glad tidings. That was their job, to bring glad tidings. It goes right along with your message today. And so, and the third verse of that song talks about all of the, you know, the noise around us that blocks out us hearing. Even at the very birth of Christ, the noise around us blocks out the good news, blocks out the songs of the angels. And so I think even when we sing these carols, that have become so precious to us, it reminds us that yes, in the middle of the bombs dropping, even near the city where Jesus was born, even in the midst of all of that, we've got to block out some of that noise, at least enough to hear the message behind the angels still singing, bringing that message of good tidings.
I love
and that's
that.
Us. We've got to be those angels.
I never thought of that song like that, but that's beautiful. And I completely love that. That's so beautiful. You are wonderful. Thank you for being here, my friend. You make just being on the earth, you make my Christmas better every year.
Thank you. I love you.
Thank you. I love you too, sweetheart. Our wonderful senior pastor, Keith Mazingo. If you want to know how you can donate to Saturday Night Spiritual to help us help you to help others, you can text 77977. Don't forget to put, you know, Saturday Night Spiritual, that you like it just a little bit and you like Reverend Sheen a little bit. I have to say that. That's part of my job. You like me. You really like me. And also, if you can't do it through text, You can go to foundersmcc.org, of course, and there's instructions for how to do it there. We do a lot of outreach, and the more we get in the way of donations, the more we can help other people. That's why I call it help us to help you to help others. Thank you. And now I would like to bring up our wonderful Adrian Christian to do some more music for us.
Rejoice with me, please. Oh, come, O ye faithful, joyful and triumphant. O come ye, O come ye to Bethlehem. Come and behold him, born the King of angels. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord. Sing, choirs of angels, sing in exultation. Sing, all ye citizens of heaven above. Glory to God in the highest. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore him. Christ the Lord, the Lord, the Lord, the Lord. Yes, Christmas Eve in the past, he would go to midnight mass. He'd sing songs of praise with gin on his breath, his mind in a haze. Not a day went by he didn't need to get higher. The taste of each drink as sweet as the sound of the choir. His famous song of the season is always ringing in his ears. His New Year's resolution, he put down the bottle, it's been almost a year. This Christmas will be the first one in a long time. Midnight will be clear. Midnight will be clear. He'd been on a downhill slide, lost friends, his job, his pride. He sank to his knees, looked up at the stars, said, Lord, help me please. As soon as he did, he'd felt peace in his soul. On this holy day, he'd sing that glorious song of old. His favorite song of the season is always ringing in his ears. His New Year's resolution, he put down the bottle, it's been almost a year. This Christmas will be the first one in a long time. Midnight will be clear. Midnight will be clear.
There are 12 steps he follows. There are 12 days of Christmas. The only one thing that saved him, the love of Jesus. His favorite song of the season, it came upon a midnight clear. His moon year's resolution, he put down the bottle, it's been almost a year. This Christmas will be the first one in a long time. Midnight will be clear. Midnight will be clear. It came upon a midnight clear. This Christmas will be the first one in a long time. Midnight will be clear.
Need your volume. You're muted.
Thank you. Wonderful. Adrian, thank you so much. We're getting used to bringing the musical guests on and off. It's all the technology part. Thank you, my friend, for the beautiful music. We appreciate you.
Thank you so much. God bless you and everyone.
God bless you, honey. Happy holidays. Thank you to our beautiful senior pastor, Keith Mazingo, and the wonderful and beautiful social justice minister, Lucia Chappelle. I'm Sheena Metal. I'm the interfaith pastor here at Founders MCC. You can find me at SheenaMetalSpiritual.com. Reach out if you just want to know that you are joy for the world and you are medicine for the world. I am here to show you that. I hope you all have a wonderful holiday season. You can find us at foundersmcc.org and on our Facebook page and on our YouTube page. And you can donate by texting 77977. You can find SaturdayNightSpiritual.com is our community page, and our archive page to watch archive services is RevSheenaFoundersMCC.org. Until I see you next time, seek peace, live in love, lead with kindness, embrace unity, even though I know that's hard. Work always to raise your vibration and the vibrations of others around you, and always the vibration of the everything. But most importantly, this holiday season, know that you are love and you are loved, and you're so loved by me. And I love you so much. And everybody you saw today on this service, they love you too. I'm Reverend Sheena. Happy holidays and Saturday Night Spiritual. I'll see you next month.